to be Catholic to call, anybody can call 888-318-7884. But I'll tell you what, Jimmy Akin's here with us both hours. And once people hear Jimmy Akin's here, usually those phones will fill right up. So you might want to start dialing 888-318-7884. Jimmy Akin, of course, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers and the proprietor of Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. Hello, Jimmy Akin.
Hey, Cy Kellett, it's been a long time. We haven't worked together in at least 3 hours. We did a really nice pre-record this morning for Labor Day.
Yeah, that's right. We happen to be among the few who know that already know that the Labor Day show is good. So it's all. But as you know, with me, Jimmy,
I say that because you said right before we went on the air that, oh, I better not refer to the recording we did this morning. And I thought I'd refer to it then.
Yeah, that's the thing is I'll forget that that's not a show that's aired yet. And so then I'll start referring back to, remember when you said this on the air or you were talking about what's his name? Heels. Something Heel Jack. Spring Heel Jack.
Yeah.
That we haven't ever talked about Spring Heel Jack. We will.
Not yet.
Yeah. Right. What's dropping this week on Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World?
Shadow people. There are people who have reported seeing dark, mysterious figures in their house, and sometimes the so-called shadow people walk through walls. Sometimes they attack people. Sometimes they talk to people. And so we had a patron who wanted to hear all about shadow people, and so that's what we're going to be talking about. What are they? How long have they been around? And what could possibly be responsible for these experiences?
Was this did Art Bell used to talk about this? It seems to me,
yes,
that he had something like, yeah. So yeah, shadow people was one of his things.
It was Art Bell's show that gave them a name. They gave them that name. It's a phenomenon that's been around for a long time. In fact, back into prehistoric times, meaning before written records. But it really became attached to the name Shadow People as a result of an Art Bell show. So we talk about that. In fact, we play some clips from Art Bell to let people hear about the birth of the modern Shadow People phenomena.
I got it. Yeah. The AM Coast to Coast. Was that what the show was? AM Coast to Coast AM. Coast to Coast AM. Yeah. And I never knew if that was morning or radio AM, but I gathered radio, AM radio. I don't know.
I don't know.
How about we go to calls? Here we got Chuck in Cincinnati,
yeah,
Ohio.
Let's do that.
All right. Chuck in Cincinnati, watching on YouTube. You are numero uno today. Go ahead, Chuck, with your question.
Thanks a lot, Sly. Hello, Mr. Akin. And by the way, I'm evangelical and shadow people are easy to deal with. But anyway, that's not
good.
The reason why I'm calling. So I'm just going down the line of questions as I can, because I know I can only ask one question at a time. But so I do not believe you can increase your justification because I'm evangelical, but I'm wanting to understand your faith, of course. Mm-hmm. But if a Roman Catholic were not to commit mortal sin, is it still necessary to increase in justification through increased merit, or regardless if you commit a mortal sin, you still need to increase in justification to obtain eternal life?
The only requirement. Yeah, the only requirement in order to get into heaven after you've entered a state of justification is that you don't leave it. And the only way to leave a state of justification is by committing a mortal sin. Therefore, that's all you have to do once you are in a state of justification is just stay in it, don't commit mortal sin. It is natural to do more than that, because as Paul says in Ephesians 2, we were created in Christ for good works. And so the Holy Spirit leads us to do good works, and it's in our hearts to do good works, because what, as a result of justification, we have the virtue of charity in our hearts. Charity is a form of supernatural love whereby we love God above all things and we love our neighbor as ourselves. And if you're a loving person, you're going to want to show that. You're going to want to do loving things. And so it's natural to go ahead and do works and thus increase in righteousness. But that's not what's required in order to go to heaven. What's required in order to go to heaven is to not leave a state of justification. Now, let me ask you a question. So I understand, because, sure, you know, I used to be a Protestant myself, that Protestants don't commonly think in terms of growth in righteousness. They tend to view justification or righteousness as a binary state, something that's either on or off and that does not admit of degrees. But would you acknowledge that when, you know, we come to God and he gives us the virtues of faith, hope, and love, that it's possible to grow in love, to be have a greater degree of charity than you, say, did at the beginning of your Christian life? Is that something that you would be prepared to consider reasonable, that you could grow in charity or grow in love?
Well, as personal character, as far as sanctification, and that we so mm-hmm. we do separate the two, right? I mean, as far mm-hmm. as what evangelicals believe, there's a distinction from justification, which is we would consider it as a definition, it's being declared righteous, not made or infused, although there's an imputation of Christ's righteousness, and we believe that. That's not a Lutheran invention. I mean, the apostles talked about it. So, but as far as spiritual growth, because I love the Lord, because what he's already done for me, I would do things for the sake out of love for the Lord. Lord, you saved me. Everything's been front-loaded, my justification. I'm in union with Christ. I'm crucified with Christ. I'm buried with Christ, raised with him. I have his righteousness. I actually have his glory, 2 Thessalonians 2:14. Okay. I have everything that I need. And because of that, Lord, I love you, and I'm going to do things. I'm going to obey you. I have fear of the Lord, which is the beginning of the gospel. That's Revelation. So, I'm not sure if I'm answering your question, okay, Mr. Aiken.
It doesn't exactly sound like it, but so to put it concisely, I mean, you're saying a lot of great stuff, but my question is, let's say you come to God at age 8, or let's make it a little later. Let's say you come to God at age 19, and so for the first time, you're justified, you're in a state of grace at age 19, and then you go on to live to be 98, and you've spent all these years with God under the influence of his sanctification, do you acknowledge that you could be a more loving person at age 98 than you were at age 19? Can you grow in love?
As far as being molded in the image of his son, mm-hmm. yes, in that sense.
Yeah, okay. Good. That's great. We agree, then, I would say, on the fundamental insight here. It may not be traditional in an evangelical context to refer to that as a growth in righteousness, but we are progressively conformed to the image of Christ. We do become more loving, and in that sense, we grow in justification, or we grow in righteousness. So we may use different language to articulate the insight, but I would say that we have the same fundamental substance here, the same fundamental insight onto growth as a Christian under the influence of God's grace. And so consequently, this would amount to a quarrel about terminology. You know, exactly what terminology should we use to label this? And at that point, it's worth not arguing about it. St. Paul says we shouldn't fight about words, that they just ruin the hearers. And as long as we're agreed on the substance, then that's something we can rejoice about, even if we don't use the same terms for it.
And Chuck, I got to go take a break, so we will leave it there. What a wonderful way to start our open forum. Thank you very much for that call, Chuck. We'll take this break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live. Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
It is a tremendous privilege to be able to speak to so many of you and to know that so many of you are listening to The Answers, which we want to give you so that you can know the truth of Jesus and come to love him more.
EWTN Open Line Wednesday with Father Mitch Pacwa, tomorrow afternoon, 3 Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akins, our guest. 2 hours of open forum today. Try to beat that. Just give us a call if you've got a question, whether you're Catholic or a Christian or not, whether your call is a religious or a philosophical or even scientific question, you're welcome. 888-318-7884. We're going to go to our friend Emma in Hayden, Idaho, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. It's all right if I call you our friend, right, Emma?
Oh, absolutely. I got to tell you, remember I said I was going to add up all the books you gave me and donate it to you guys?
Yes.
$160.74.
Well, you're very kind to make a donation, but that is our donors who make that possible. The people who give to this program are the ones who make that possible.
Still,
so I'm glad we were able to give that to you, Emma.
You can't outgive God. So.
Amen, sister.
I'm going for that. Okay. I'm wondering just what is a doctor of the church? How do you become one? Because I think there's some that are more modern, you know, in not so olden days time. I'm sorry, I got my grandson. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what the difference is with them between just a member of the church or a priest or bishop or that whole thing.
Okay. So the secret is in the name. The word doctor is a Latin word that means teacher. And so the doctors of the church are people who have taught the church. And what that amounts to in practice is they have made important theological contributions to the history of Catholic thought. They've articulated the Christian faith in ways that were particularly accurate, that were particularly useful, and so forth. And so the title doctor or teacher is given to them by the Pope as a way of acknowledging their contributions to Christian teaching. And also it serves as a kind of recommendation. So that if someone, let's say St. Augustine or St. Teresa of Lisieux, is named a doctor of the church, that signifies that this is a good person to learn from. They're a good teacher of the faith. Doesn't mean everything they say is right, but it does mean that they were a faithful and insightful teacher that it's worth learning from. And in terms of how one becomes a doctor of the church, well, you want to be a saint. So there's a good entry point. The church isn't in the habit of naming people doctors who aren't also saints, and you want to make important contributions to the teaching of the Christian faith. So if you do those two things, if you become a saint and if you make important contributions to the teaching of the faith, then it's possible that someday in the future, people will recognize that and it will be brought to the attention of the Pope. They have a dicastery over at the Vatican that, you know, considers who should be named doctors of the church, and they make recommendations to the Pope. And if the Pope agrees, then the Pope might proclaim you a doctor of the church.
Emma, thanks very much. Thanks for your kind donation, for those books. But we're very happy to give them to you. And once again, that's our donors that make that possible. We give away thousands of dollars of printed materials every year, and the donors make that possible. I'm going to go up to Ontario, Canada now. Ava in Ontario, Canada, watching on YouTube. Ava, you there with us?
Yes, hello.
Hi, Ava. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
All right. So my question is about a show that I watch. It's called Cadfael. It's about a Welsh monk that lived in England in the 12th century. He solves mysteries.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Anyway, starring Derek Jacobi.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But in one episode, there was a man who had been married 10 years and all of a sudden he decides that his true vocation is to become a monk. So he goes and he talks to the monks, and they accept him, even though his wife is very vocal in saying how upset she is and how she doesn't want to lose her husband. And she says this repeatedly to both her husband and the monks. But in the end, they decide he becomes a monk anyway. And when he becomes a monk, she's not allowed to get remarried. And so I was wondering, can married people become monks? Wouldn't marriage be his true vocation because he thought that God was calling him to be a monk? So wouldn't marriage be his true vocation? Why can't she get remarried? And if married people can become monks, if their wife didn't want them to, would that bear in on the subject because they promised to be her husband before they became a monk?
Wow.
Okay, so in principle, yes, married people can become monks or nuns, and so women can do this too. If a married person becomes a monk or a nun, then they then the other party cannot get married to someone else because they're as once you're married, if it's a valid marriage, you're married to that person for the rest of your life. And so you couldn't marry someone else because your current spouse is still alive. So as long as the current spouse is still alive, you couldn't remarry. And obviously, the situation you describe from Cadfile is one that seems quite unjust to the woman in question, to be abandoned by her husband, and he goes off to a monastery and she no longer has a husband or the ability to marry someone else. That seems very unjust to her. And while I can't comment on whether situations like this actually happened in church history, they may or may not have, it is an that particular scenario is unjust. And so the church would not permit that today. Today, if you have a married couple and one of them decides that they want to pursue a monastic vocation, whether as a monk or a nun, it has to be by mutual agreement. They have to agree that this is what's going to happen. And there have been cases in history where a couple would be married for a time, they might raise children, and then they would decide to both pursue monastic vocations, and the husband would become a monk and the wife would become a nun. And if they choose to do that, if they do that of their own free will, neither of them objects, then that's a legitimate thing to do. But it is illegitimate. It is not the right thing to do to abandon a spouse in order to pursue a monastic mode of life. And consequently, the church would not permit that. Certainly not today. It would say, no. If your spouse wants to continue living as spouses, that's what you need to do. You need to stick with your spouse. You can't abandon them for the monastery. So that's a sketch of that kind of situation. Yes, it's possible for married people to become monks or nuns, but no, you can't do it over the objection of your spouse.
It sounds like you kind of had... That's kind of what you thought would be the answer, Ava. Is that right?
Yes, I thought that it was rather unreasonable, the scenario in the show.
Yeah, and incidentally, the same thing applies to deacons, because deacons can be married, but if a man is going to be ordained a deacon, his wife has to consent.
Hmm. Ava, thanks. Maybe we'll get to talk with you again sometime. Thanks for the call.
All right, thank you very much. Goodbye.
Goodbye. I'm going to go down to Maria in Bermuda because usually we move the international sure. calls to the top. So Maria in Bermuda watching on YouTube, you are next. Hi, Maria.
Hi. My question.
Nope, go ahead. You're fine. That was me. Go ahead.
My question is about time and how they say that in science, they say that there's multiple like choices that we can make. So we actually make many choices, but there's a timeline where I did something like sinful, mortally, a mortal sin, and then there's a timeline where I didn't. I was wondering if that's possible because that's a scary thought.
Well, it's possible. This is, as you say, this is a scientific matter, so it's not really a matter of church teaching. The church doesn't have a view of this one way or another. But what I can say is this is not at all universally the opinion in science. This is a particular interpretation of a field in physics called quantum mechanics. And there are scientists working on quantum mechanics who adopt the interpretation that every time an event happens, a new timeline branches, or a set of new timelines branch, that reflect everything that could have happened. So, for example, if I'm eating, let's do a little bit of remedial chaos theory here. If I'm eating dinner with some friends and we've ordered pizza, and a pizza man comes to the door and one of us needs to go get the pizza, we could roll a die and see who goes and gets the pizza. You know, if it's a one, it's you. If it's a two, it's you. If it's a three, it's you. We could roll a die that, let's say there's six of us friends. And so who goes to the door is a choice, and there are six possible choices. So by rolling the die, we would be creating six alternate timelines. And they each might play out differently from there. Some might be better than others. Some might be worse than others. There might be a darkest timeline. But that's possible as an interpretation of how quantum mechanics works. But lots of physicists would say, yeah, that's a possible interpretation of quantum mechanics, but it is not the only one. And so you will also have physicists who will say, no, there's really only one timeline. The idea of alternate timelines is not real science, because there's no way to prove it or disprove it. It's metaphysical speculation. And therefore, it's not a matter of science, because in order for something to be a scientific view, it needs to be testable. And there's no way to test whether alternate timelines exist. Therefore, that's a matter of philosophy, or it's a matter of faith. It's not a matter of science. And so it is not at all guaranteed that there are other timelines.
Okay, Maria?
Yes. I was kind of worried about what happened if Jesus, in a different timeline, they didn't kill him, or something different, if that was like something that was possible.
Yeah, so, well,
I have some stuff to think about.
In terms of what would have happened if they hadn't killed Jesus, it's possible. We don't really know, because God hasn't told us. God could redeem us in any number of different ways. God knows an infinite number of ways to redeem us. And if the Jewish authorities and Romans had not killed Jesus, it's possible he would have died in some other way to redeem us, or it's possible God could have redeemed us in some other way. So we haven't been told. We kind of have to leave that in God's hands.
Maria, thank you very much for the question. I feel like, I don't know that I'm certain of this, I feel like that pizza example has actually been on television at a certain point. There was an episode of a television show where they rolled the dice and showed the six different outcomes.
Yeah. That would be season three of Community, the episode Remedial Chaos Theory.
Maria, thanks very, very much with that for that question about the multiverse of madness. I'm going to come right back here to El Cajon, California, where Jonathan's watching on YouTube. Jonathan, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, guys. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, so this question is such a big deal for me, and a huge stumbling block from me kind of coming into the Roman Catholic Church. The last 5 days, I kind of studied it for like 30 plus hours, was in Facebook groups, and this is my question.
Okay.
The problem I see with the modern church is, compared to the early Catholic Church, is the hierarchy government that Paul taught as doctrine in Ephesians chapter 4, 9 through 13, and it actually started with Jesus first, Luke 11:49, where Jesus says that I'm going to send them apostles and prophets. Ephesians 4 chapter says he gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, evangelists, teachers, and pastors. Then he confirms that doctrine again in 1 Corinthians 12:27-28, where he says, and God ordained let me pull it up real quick. And God has appointed these in the church: first apostles, second prophets, third teachers. And then he confirms it again, 1 Corinthians 14:29-32. It says, let two or three prophets speak and let the others judge. And then, apart from that, there's four verses in the book of Acts where Luke specifically states that position in the church, with Acts 21, 10 through 11, where it says, and as we stayed many days, a certain prophet named Agabus came from Judea. Then again, Luke says, then one of them named Agabus stood up, showed this, oh, it doesn't say prophet. Sorry, let me move on to the next one. Now, Judas and Silas themselves being prophets also exhorted and strengthened the brethren with many words. Acts 15:32. Last one,
Jonathan,
Acts 20:27. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, you can hear the music. We got to take a break. Well, I think Jimmy's got the picture. If he needs more, he'll let you know. But we'll address the question, and then I'll come back and see if it satisfies you. But first, we got to take this break. Right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live.
Can you defend the Church's teaching on the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist? Do you desire a deeper relationship with our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament? Join us September 22nd through 25th for the annual Catholic Answers Conference in San Diego. This year's theme is the Eucharist. I am with you always. Featuring all the Catholic Answers speakers and special guest Bishop Thomas Papracki, use promo code EARLY to save $50 when you register at CatholicAnswersConference.com.
Want to know more about the origins of the Catholic Church? Joe Heschmeyer explores the beginnings of Christianity in The Early Church Was the Catholic Church. Joe digs deep into the words and actions of those who lived right after the apostles to refute anti-Catholic claims of how the faith was lived back then. Order your copy of The Early Church Was the Catholic Church today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Have you rescued a pet and why? We're doing a part two about that.
We want to hear about it tomorrow on Take Two with Jerry and Debbie.
On most of these EWTN stations.
Now we return to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. It's Open Forum. You're welcome to call. If you've got a question about Christianity, about the Catholic faith, maybe you got a moral question, philosophical, even scientific question, they're all welcome, especially when Jimmy's here. 888-318-7884. And anybody can call. You don't have to be Catholic to get on with us. We'd love to talk with you. 888-318-7884. Jonathan, right here in El Cajon, that's where we are. We're in El Cajon, California. Call is on the line with a question about the difference between what appears to be Paul's and Luke's description of the early church and the church today. That's at least what I was getting from the question, Jimmy. What about you?
Yeah, so this is an instance of what is known as progressive revelation. It's also kind of related to doctrinal development, except in this case, because it applies to the church, we might call it ecclesial development. But what we can see is that I'm going to set the issue of prophets to one side because Joshua or Jonathan was talking about how there are prophets in the New Testament. And that's fine. There are prophets today, too. God doesn't stop giving people the gift of prophecy. So down through history, there have been various people who've had the gift of prophecy, and they continue in the church. It's one of the charismatic gifts that the Holy Spirit sometimes gives. He may not give it as often today as he gave it back then, but he does continue to give it. And And it is an extremely useful gift because it's a way of getting information from God that is going to be reliable and that is going to be useful. And so it's a useful gift that continues to exist today. In terms of the other offices, now he mentioned apostle in particular, but there are other offices that we see in the New Testament, including deacons and presbyters or priests. Priest is just an English form of the Greek word presbyteros, which means elder, and also bishops or episkopoi. Now, what we see is that initially, during the ministry of Jesus, none of these offices existed. It was just Jesus himself. He began his ministry. He didn't have any officers. He didn't have underlings doing stuff. But he began preaching, and he attracted a group of followers. And eventually, from among that group of followers, he appointed 12. And these 12 disciples then became known as apostles. In Greek, the word apostolos means sent one. And so that told you something about the function that these 12 people were going to perform. They were going to go out and be sent by Jesus to preach his message. Then we see Jesus dies and returns to life and then ascends to heaven. And the only officers in the church at this point are the apostles. But we see that situation change. In Acts chapter 7, I may be misstating that it may be 6. There is a dispute in the Jerusalem church about the distribution of charitable resources. And you have Hellenistic Jews saying their widows are being neglected in the daily food distribution. And so to deal with the situation, the apostles appoint a group of 7 men to oversee the charitable distributions in a way that's fair to everybody. And in particular, they pick 7 guys with Hellenistic names. So they pick 7 Hellenistic Jews to make sure that the Hellenistic widows are getting their fair share of the resources. Now, a lot of people have looked at this and said, oh, that's the institution of the office of deacon. But really, no. Biblical scholars have looked at this and said, yeah, this it never calls them deacons. They're not associated with deacons. They're just a group that we can call the 7 that were local to Jerusalem. But what that shows us is that the 12, the apostles, or at least this group of apostles, had the ability to institute additional offices for the good of the church. So the structure of the church is something that, at least within some limits, is capable of developing over time, and various ministries can be instituted in it, and so forth. We then see that by the time of Paul's first missionary journey, which is Acts chapter 13 through 14, there are also presbyteroi, or elders, or priests in the church, because they get mentioned. And when Paul is on the way back from the second missionary journey, he stops off at the churches he evangelized and appoints presbyters for them. And this is an office that had previously existed in the Jewish synagogue. They had presbyters in the Jewish community as well, but now that office has been adopted in the Christian community. But it wasn't there when Jesus was around. He didn't appoint presbyters. He appointed just the 12. And so this is a new thing in the Christian community. Paul may not have been the first to do it, but at some point between the crucifixion and the first missionary journey, we start having presbyters being appointed. Later, we also read about deacons, and by the time of the pastoral epistles, we read about bishops or episkopoi. And at the time, bishop and episkopoi were both synonyms for the same office. There really wasn't a distinction between the office of presbyter or priest and the office of bishop. But we know by the end of the first century, there was, because at the beginning of the second century, around the year AD 108, the bishop of Antioch in Syria was a man named Ignatius. And he wrote, he was being taken to Rome for martyrdom. And on his way, he wrote letters to a bunch of churches that he was passing. And in his letters, he indicates that the different churches he's visiting have bishops and priests and deacons. And in fact, he says that without a bishop and priests and deacons, you don't even have a church. You need all three of those offices to be a properly constituted church. So by the end, and there's evidence of that in that they had them all over the place, as evidenced by his letters. So we can see that by the end of the apostolic age, this threefold office of ministry had become standard, and it's remained standard ever since. So the threefold office of bishop, priest, and deacon has been the standard model of church governance down through Christian history. We also know that the office of apostle passed away. We don't have apostles around today. The bishops have taken their place as the supreme governors of the church, but we don't have apostles today. And the reason for that is suggested by another statement of St. Paul. In 2 Corinthians, he's talking, he's defending his ministry as an apostle, and he says to his readers, "Am I not an apostle? Have I not seen the Lord?" And seeing the Lord seems to be a requirement for being sent by the Lord. And similarly, we have at the beginning of Acts, in Acts chapter 1, when they replace Judas, who has committed suicide, Peter says, okay, for his replacement, he needs to be, and this is to join the 12, so not just to be an apostle, but to be an apostle who is a member of the 12, he needs to have been with us from the time that Jesus was baptized through the ascension. He needs to be an eyewitness, not just to have seen the Lord, but to have been an eyewitness of his whole ministry. Well, obviously, no one today could be a member of the 12 because no one today was an eyewitness of Jesus's whole ministry. But even beyond that, no one today would be an apostle because Jesus has not appeared to them and made them an apostle the way he made Paul an apostle. And so we see that even though there is a hierarchical structure to the church, that is something that was willed by Christ, the exact nature of that hierarchy changed over the course of the apostolic age, which is during the period when public revelation was being given. And by the end of the apostolic age, it had reached its final form. So when the apostles passed from the scene, the structure that they had established of bishop, priest, and deacon continued forward thereafter. And so Jonathan is quite correct to point to various passages in the New Testament that describe the situation during the New Testament era in the apostolic age, but we also need to be sensitive to the development that is occurring over the course of the apostolic age, because it wasn't originally, there were no presbyters, there were no deacons, there were no apostles outside of the 12, it was just the 12. And then these other things grew, and we want then to, for purposes of determining what should the church look like today, we want to look at the end product. What was the structure that the apostles left with the church going forward for the period after the apostolic age?
Jonathan, I have time just for a couple seconds of a response from you, but and then an invitation for you. But does that help you, Jonathan?
Yeah, the only trouble with him saying that, or Mr. Atkins, you saying about the prophets, the apostles all had to see Jesus. What are your thoughts on Acts 14:14, where it declares Barnabas also an apostle?
I would assume Barnabas had also seen Jesus.
Oh, okay. And then, so are you saying like, as I'm reading the Catholic Bible in the book of Corinthians, where Paul instructs the church, when they get together, he gives a whole list of what should happen within the meeting, an actual church meeting. He talks, it seems evident that there was prophets there. It was like commonplace for that office to exist. Are you saying that, do we just ignore that scripture? I mean, it doesn't exist anymore, well, I guess.
So Paul talks about if you're going to, he says that it's desirable to have prophets, and that if prophets speak in church, they should do it in an orderly manner, and no more than a few of them should do it. It's really dependent on God, because prophecy is a spiritual gift, and we don't have a choice about whether we are prophets or not. We can pray to God and ask God to give us that gift if it's his will. And in fact, Paul encourages the Corinthians to pray for that gift in preference to the gift of tongues. But whether or not a miraculous gift is given is up to the Holy Spirit. And so we're not in control of that. And Christian experience has found that the spiritual gifts that are given fluctuate, or how common they are fluctuates over the course of church history. So here in the apostolic age itself, when Christianity was first being set up, we see a lot of spiritual gifts being given, including the gift of prophecy. We then see that although prophecy continues in later church history, it drops off beginning in the second century, presumably because the church is now established. And so it doesn't need as many miraculous gifts to continue functioning. And then at other times in church history, based on the pastoral needs in society, God may give a given spiritual gift more. So, for example, to help prepare for the events of the 20th century and the struggle with Soviet communism, God gave the apparitions of Fatima in 1917, and that helped the church prepare to wrestle with the threat of Soviet communism in the 20th century because of a change in society. If Russia had not become communist, then presumably those apparitions would not have occurred, or they would have taken some other form, because their purpose was to help people deal with the current experience. And so the spiritual gifts that are being given in any age are reflective, or they reflect the current needs of the church, and they're therefore gifts that God gives the church to help deal with those needs. And it's understandable that in its foundational period, when it was very, very, very small, that God might give extra gifts to help the church get a running start, and then you would see them drop off but fluctuate over the course of church history. So applying that to today, most parishes do not have reliable prophets living in them, and so it wouldn't be appropriate to try to force it and run ahead of the Holy Spirit and force some people to prophecy when, in fact, that is not their gift.
Jonathan, thank you so much. You're in our town, so I'd love to invite you to come over and visit with us. Would you send me, if you'd like to come visit and meet the folks, and because there's lots of people who can have these conversations with you in person and would love to, just send it to radio@catholic.com if you'd like. And in the meantime, I'd like to send you a copy of Jimmy's book, The Words of Eternal Life, True Happiness and Where to Find It. If you'd like a copy of that, just hang on and we'll get your address and we'll send it on to you. We got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin right after this.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Do you love praying for people? Have you ever wanted to use your gift of prayer to share Jesus with others and build up the body of Christ? Start a public prayer station with St. Paul Street Evangelization. Listen to people's needs, pray with them, or invite them to meet you at church. St. Paul Street Evangelization can help you get started. Find out how at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
EWTN, teaching the truth.
I did not grow up religious. This morning, as I was chaotically driving around looking for a COVID testing site, I actually saw your radio station on somebody's car in front of me. Something told me to listen up, and so I switched up to the station and just started listening. And now here I am on the phone talking to you guys.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Still got some spots for the big Catholic Answers Conference coming up last weekend in September. We'd love to see you there. Maybe you've got a group. If you're local and you got a group, shoot us an email and we'll figure out how to accommodate your group. Maybe you're an individual and you'd like to come, or a family. Head on over to CatholicAnswersConference.com and you can find out all about it. CatholicAnswersConference.com. The entire conference is about Jesus in the Eucharist. And we've got the whole lineup of Catholic Answer speakers and some other very, very fine speakers coming in. CatholicAnswersConference.com. Let's go to Sean in New York, watching on YouTube. Sean, thank you for waiting. Go ahead with your question, Sean.
Hi, my question is, what do I say to someone who argues that it's impossible for a person to show the fruits of the Spirit without being regenerated first? And therefore, the proof we are regenerated is not baptism, but rather showing the outward fruits of the Spirit instead.
Okay. Well, I would say a couple of things. Now, it seems theologically, let me make sure I understand this person's claim. You said that this person wants to say that it's impossible to show the fruits of the Spirit unless we're regenerated. Is that true?
Yeah.
So you need to be regenerated to show the fruits of the Spirit. Well, that would be regarded by Catholic theologians as a true statement. You do need to be regenerated in order to show the fruits of the Spirit. Then the second part deals with when are we regenerated? And Catholic Christianity, like historic Christianity in general, including Orthodox and Oriental and Lutheran and Anglican and Methodist and all kinds of people, have acknowledged that we are regenerated in baptism. And there is good evidence for that in Scripture. We see multiple statements about the efficacy of baptism. In 1 Peter 3:21, Peter flat out says, baptism now saves you. That's one of the clearest. There are others as well. And the early church fathers understood this as in addition. They also recognized universally that baptism is the means by which we are regenerated or given new life in Christ. That's what regeneration is. And so you have a teaching of the New Testament that is clear enough that the vast majority of Christians have accepted it throughout history, and that was also universally accepted among the church fathers. And so if your friend wants to claim that we're not regenerated in baptism, but in some other way, then he's going to need to deal with the evidence from Scripture and from the church fathers that indicates that we are regenerated in baptism.
Okay. Sean?
Okay. So what would I have to say to him when he says, look, there are people that aren't even baptized, but it looks like they're showing the fruits of the Spirit? That's what he says to me.
Well, so this is why I phrased myself a little bit carefully earlier. God can work outside of the sacraments. And so God can and does give his grace to people even if they're not baptized. God does, for example, as Jesus says, give his son and reign to everybody. And the same thing is true in a certain respect with spiritual grace as well. Sun and rain are kind of natural graces, but it shows that God can give good things or graces to people even if they're not Christian. And the same thing is true of unbaptized people. If they are, let's say they don't know that they need to be baptized, but they are otherwise trying to follow God and do charitable things and fulfill God's will and be loving towards God and neighbor, God can work with those people. They're not regenerated in the proper sense. They haven't been baptized per the conditions of this thought experiment, but God can still be giving them his grace and working through them. So there are exceptional situations that deviate from what God really wants from us, but that nevertheless are situations where God can still be working. But if you want to do God's will, you need to focus not on what's possible, but what God has said he wants. And what he wants is for us to be baptized, and we are told that baptism will save us and regenerate us by Scripture. So God may be able to give certain graces associated with salvation to people who are not baptized, but if you want to do God's will, you need to be baptized. You don't want to let the exceptions erode away the rule. God has revealed the rule, and so we need to focus on the rule while acknowledging the exceptions. We don't want to pretend that the rule doesn't exist just because there are exceptions.
And I'm going to leave it there, Sean. Thank you very much. I hope it was helpful to you. I want to get to this question because Manny in Massachusetts, who was listening on 1060 AM, the Station of the Cross, wasn't able to stay on the line, but he had a question I really would like you to answer, Jimmy. So I'll just read Manny's question. Manny asked, does the church have any teaching on whether the soul of a deceased person can linger as a ghost? For example, in the sense of a house being haunted.
Well, the church teaches that the souls of the departed continue to exist, and that God can allow these souls to manifest to the living, at least some of the time. So, for example, that happens with the Virgin Mary or some of the other saints. They may appear to people, and in the church and in parapsychology, when such a soul appears to someone, it's called an apparition. Because apparition means an appearance. And so if the soul of a departed person appears to you, that's an apparition. Well, that's a little different. It's a little different to have a vision of the Virgin Mary than what we think of as a ghost. And here the church doesn't so much have a teaching, but there is a tradition and a theological opinion on this. Historically, now I'm sure you can find theologians who would disagree with this, but historically, it has been recognized that it's not just the saints who can appear to us, that other souls can appear to us as well, and that this is responsible for various phenomena that could be classified as ghostly. For example, St. Thomas Aquinas held that all three types of departed human souls can appear to us. The saints can appear to us, but so can souls in purgatory, and even by God's permission, so can souls who are in hell. Now, when people in purgatory appear, because purgatory is not a fully pleasant experience, they might display some distress. You know, they might moan or something like that. And one of the goals of a person in purgatory appearing to the living might be to obtain prayers so that they could get out of purgatory faster. Or it could otherwise be just part of them working out their experience in purgatory. Like there have been reports down through the years, let's say you're a nun in a monastery and you're slack in your religious duties. Let's say you deliberately daydreamed when you were in Eucharistic adoration. Well, there have been reports down through Catholic history of a deceased nun appearing in the adoration chapel of her monastery to do the adoration that she neglected to do while she was alive. And so that could be part of the healing process for her, getting rid of the disordered desires that led her to deliberately fantasize about other things and ignore her duties. So those are some possibilities in terms of a soul in hell appearing to us. It might be to scare the living back onto the straight and narrow so that they don't end up damned as well. Kind of actually in a Christmas Carol, Jacob Marley is in purgatory, but, there's one more thing to say about that. So there's a nice cliffhanger for us to talk about on the other side of the break.
Beautiful. Manny, I hope you're listening. If not, somebody that knows Manny, let him know so he can come back and listen to this. We'll continue with Open Forum when we come back. Open Forum means open to anyone. If you would like to call, we would love to talk with you. 888-318-7884. Whether you're Catholic or not, whatever your question is. 888-318-7884. Right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Having fun with Jimmy Akin on this Tuesday afternoon or Tuesday evening, maybe where you are, maybe even Wednesday morning. Whatever it is, we're happy you're here. And it's open forum. Call and ask whatever you like. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. Jimmy, once again, on this week's Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World, just so I don't forget to ask this hour, it is the Shadow People.
Correct,
should I be afraid?
Yes. Not particularly, but it is a little spooky, but not too much.
Okay. All right. Shadow People coming up. Check out Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. A whole bunch of folks on the line. As a matter of fact, it looks to me like every line full. I don't know if I'm reading that wrong, but it looks like every line full. So off we go.
Well, actually, we had a little bit of an answer to tie up from last hour.
Okay. So let me set that up again. Manny asked about the church's teaching on ghosts, essentially. So you had one more point to make on that. And I apologize, Jimmy. Go ahead.
Yeah, no problem. So Manny had asked about ghosts, and we talked and hauntings, and we had talked about apparitions. Now, most of the times when a deceased person appears to a living person, I mean, it can be in a vision, but if it's acting like a classical ghost, if it's not like talking to you and saying, "Hey, I've got a revelation from God," you know, if it's like. Yeah. If it's like you see a nun and that you know is deceased and she's in a chapel adoring the Eucharist, or if you are somewhere and you hear a ghost moaning or something, that person is probably in purgatory. And they're probably either God is letting them work out their purgatory in association with an earthly location and is allowing you to perceive it for your good. And also possibly for the good of the person, because you can then pray for them. And, you know, maybe have mass said for them and help them get through purgatory more easily. So a lot of classic ghosts, assuming they're actually, you know, that there is a supernatural thing happening here and it's not just water pipes or an illusion or something like that, but assuming there is an actual spirit manifesting here, it would probably be someone from purgatory. But Manny also asked about hauntings, and that term in ordinary colloquial speech is synonymous with just any kind of ghostly appearance. So in ordinary English, there's no distinction between an apparition and a haunting. It's a little different in Catholic language. We do have the term apparition for when a spirit appears, but there's no real word for haunting in theological language. Similarly, in parapsychology, both terms do appear, but they don't mean what you would think. In parapsychology, and I've taken classes in this, in fact, I've even been certified as a paranormal field investigator, but in parapsychology, an apparition is where a spirit appears and you can interact with the spirit. You know, you can ask questions, the spirit can tell you stuff. That's an apparition, just like it would be in Catholic circles, whether it's an apparition of a saint or an apparition of someone in purgatory or even an apparition of the damned. But hauntings are something else. One of the things that parapsychologists noted is that a lot of occasions when people see someone who is not alive or perceive evidence of someone who is not alive is it's not interactive. You just see the person doing the same thing over and over again. Like maybe you see the same woman descending a staircase in a house, or you see the same couple sitting on a swing on their porch and you know they're dead or something. It's just the same thing over and over again, like a recording. It's not an interactive thing where you can talk to somebody. And parapsychologists concluded that that's exactly what it is. It's a recording. The idea is that in the case of a haunting, the way the term is used in parapsychology, living people can lay down recordings, just like living people can appear in movies You know, if you watch, say, Top Hat with Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, well, Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers are no longer alive, but they recorded Top Hat, which was a 1930s musical, back when they were alive in the 1930s. And it's proposed that in the same way, living people can leave impressions, let's say, in a house where they lived for decades, or where some really emotional experience occurred, maybe a good one, maybe a bad one. And then after they have passed on, or even before they've passed on, other people who come into this location may be able to pick up on that recording. And it's even debated, is this a physical recording of some type? There are some indications it may have to do with magnetism, and it may in some way involve magnetic fields, just like a magnetic tape. On the other hand, it could be something else. So just be aware in thinking about all this that at least based on the findings of parapsychologists, not every time you encounter haunting phenomena, or you shouldn't assume every time you encounter haunting phenomena that it involves a spirit. It may not involve a spirit. It's possible that it might just be a recording that someone left when they were alive and that you're proceeding. I know that sounds weird. I know that's a new thought for a lot of people, but it's a possibility that you want to think through if you do encounter such phenomena, as well as thinking through other phenomena, other possible explanations, like could this knocking I'm hearing just be a bubble in the water pipes, or could there be infrasound that is causing me to have hallucinations, or could this be my imagination, or did I recently ingest a psychoactive substance that's causing me to have this hallucination, or other purely natural explanations that have nothing to do with the paranormal or the supernatural.
Manny, I'm so glad you got to ask the question. I hope that that answer was helpful to you. Jimmy Akin, our guest, open forum today on Catholic Answers Live. Let's go to Mankato, Minnesota. David, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. David, thank you for downloading the app onto your phone. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi.
David?
Sure. This is my question. So since COVID-19, there's been a trend towards relying on online. Yes.
You are on the air. What's your question, David?
Okay. So since COVID-19, there's a tendency to rely on online adoration. And I'm wondering,
David's listening on the radio loop, so he's hearing
David,
he's going to hear in a few seconds. I'm going to put him on hold, and we're going to come back after the break. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to take a little bit of an early break. We'll get this straightened out. We'll talk to David right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Tip, David, don't listen to the radio. Listen to your phone. There's a delay.
This is Bishop Chad Zielinski from the Diocese of Fairbanks of Northern Alaska, and you are listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I'm continually amazed and humbled at the way God can work through me to help so many people. Although I have no idea what the caller's questions will be that day, I trust that the Holy Spirit can use my education and experience to guide, challenge, or comfort those who call.
Mast Appeal with Colleen Kelly Mast, Saturday morning, 9 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kelly, your host. Actually, we're going to try to get to David in Minnesota, but we're still working on that line. So we'll go to John in Fort Myers, Florida, watching on YouTube. John, let me hear it. Are you there with us?
Yes, I am here. Can you hear me okay?
Not just you. You've got company there with you, John. Okay, go ahead. Yeah.
Tried to put him down. Yes, thank you for taking my call. This isn't meant to be a gotcha question.
Mm-hmm.
And it wouldn't mean that Christianity is false or anything like that, but it may be a good argument for the necessity of faith. So in any case, it occurred to me that it's basically that a Christian would have to say that their belief is irrational, I think, because they would commit the conjunction fallacy, because they would be asserting that it's more likely that the Old Testament and the New Testament are true. Uh-huh. Rather than the Old Testament alone. And okay. I want to get your take on that, yeah.
Okay, so what you're referring to is the conjunction fallacy is sometimes called the Linda problem. And this is an idea that was proposed by a couple of psychologists, actually, not logicians, but psychologists named Amos Tversky and Daniel Kahneman. And it's very recently proposed, so you won't find it in older textbooks of logic. But let's actually do the experiment right here on the air with Cy Kellett. And this will make the concept clear before I then proceed to talk about the Old and New Testament. So, Cy Kellett, Linda is a 31-year-old single, is 31 years old, single, outspoken, and very bright. She majored in philosophy. As a student, she was deeply concerned with issues of discrimination and social justice, and also participated in anti-nuclear demonstrations. Okay, so she's 31, single, outspoken, bright, philosophy major, deeply concerned with social issues, with discrimination and social justice, and participated in anti-nuclear demonstrations. Which of the following two options is more probable? One, Linda is a bank teller. Two, Linda is a bank teller and is active in the feminist movement. Which of those is more likely? That Linda is a bank teller, or that Linda is a bank teller and active in the feminist movement?
I suppose, and I think I got a little, with the conjunction fallacy mentioned, I got a little help here, but I think the tendency would be to say the first is more likely because it has fewer requirements to it.
That would be the interpretation that Tversky and Kahneman want you to make.
Yeah.
Because, but most people don't. Most people, when they're presented with the Linda problem, because she's outspoken, and she is concerned with discrimination, and she's concerned with social justice, they want to say, right, oh, that fits with the feminist movement. Because feminists will say, feminists are outspoken, at least the activists are, the ones who are active in the movement, and they're concerned with discrimination and social justice and things like that. So people will want to say Linda is a bank teller and is active in the in the feminist movement. But really, from a certain point of view, Padawan, the first is more likely, that Linda is a bank teller one way or the other. Because if you have fewer conditions, I mean, either way, she's a bank teller. Those are the only two options we've got. So if you then have the total pool of bank tellers and you know Linda is in that pool, that's guaranteed. It is less than guaranteed that she's also active in the feminist movement. She might have, she might have been all these things in college, and then once she got out of college and became a capitalist bank teller, she might have become a Republican and a non-feminist. You know, who knows? It's less certain that she's both than that she's just one.
Right.
So that's sometimes called the conjunction fallacy or the Linda problem. There are also criticisms of this. It has to do with the framing. The way the Linda problem is framed is designed to push you towards the idea she's a feminist. But you can reframe it in more neutral ways that don't make that. Also, the problem is ambiguous. The two options are ambiguous because the option one, Linda is a bank teller, could in context be read as Linda is a bank teller and not active in the feminist movement.
That's right. Yeah.
In which case the evidence that you've been given would point you towards the second one. So you have to be careful about the framing of the issue and what the evidence actually says. Now, let's apply that to John's question about the Old and the New Testament. So Christians assume that the Old Testament is correct, or believe that the Old Testament is correct and that the New Testament is correct, as opposed to just the Old Testament is correct. And so what John is doing is constructing a thought experiment like the Linda problem, where it would appear to be safer to just assume that the Old Testament is correct rather than add on that the New Testament is also correct. And if you knew nothing else, that would be reasonable. If you had no evidence, it would be safer to assume the option that contains fewer items. It would be safer. If you had no evidence, it would be safer to assume that just the Old Testament is correct than to assume that both the Old Testament and the New Testament are correct. But now let me give you a parallel case.
Okay.
Which of the following two options is more likely to be true? Protons exist, or protons and neutrons exist? So just protons, or protons and neutrons, which is more likely?
Well, because I know at least my basic science, it's more likely that both exist.
That's right. And it's scientific evidence that tells you that.
Yeah,
if you had no evidence about what particles exist, it would be safer to assume, okay, only protons do. But if you have evidence that says, we've also got neutrons, then the logical thing to do is the probability shifts, because that evidence that neutrons exist shifts you away from only protons exist to protons and neutrons exist. And in the same way, as a Christian apologist, I would say, in fact, I just taught a video course on this that's going to be coming out, Evidence for Christ. We have evidence that Jesus is the Messiah, that he rose from the dead, and thus that the Christian faith is true, and that the New Testament is the inspired word of God. So if I had no evidence, it would be reasonable for me to adopt the view the Old Testament is inspired versus the Old Testament and the New Testament are inspired. But in fact, I do have evidence that the New Testament is inspired, just like I have evidence that neutrons in addition to protons exist. And so as a result, it's rational for me as a Christian to conclude that both the Old Testament and the New Testament are inspired and not the Old Testament alone.
That makes sense to me. I wonder if that makes sense to our caller. John, what do you think?
Yeah, I was thinking something similar to that. I wanted to, Jimmy, I appreciate your, I've always respected your kind of philosophical leanings. And so, I thought this would be something you maybe hadn't heard before. I thought it was kind of novel. I haven't heard anybody say this. Is this the first time you've heard it?
Well, I've been familiar with the Linda problem for a long time, but it's the first time I've heard anyone apply it to this situation. And it's a reasonable thing to explore, as I said, if we had no evidence concerning the status of the Old Testament and the New Testament, it would be safer to assume that just the Old Testament is true out of those two options. But once you introduce additional evidence, it pulls us away from the first option towards the second.
John, what a pleasant conversation. Thank you very, very much for that. I wonder if you'd like Jimmy's book, A Daily Defense. I think you'd enjoy that, since you like deep thinking on these kinds of things. And it's a fun book that you can read one page at a time, one kind of challenge to the faith at a time, or read it in big chunks. But if you'd like it, hang on the line and we'll send it to you. In the meantime, I'm going to Indiana. Sarah in Indiana, watching on YouTube, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, I was wondering, does the church have any guidelines concerning taking photos of the deceased when they're in their casket? I recently received a photo like that and just found it to be disturbing, so I thought I'd give you a call.
So the church does not have any teaching on this subject. What it teaches is that we treat the dead with respect, But how that cashes out in practical terms is very dependent on culture and within cultures on individuals. So it is not something that is for everybody. Other people would say, you know, I'd rather have a picture of this person when they were alive. But there can be situations, and there can be situations where, you know, someone may have a loved one they don't have any pictures of when they were alive, but they still want to remember them, or they may have very few pictures of them when they were alive, and they still want to remember them, so they might take pictures of the person after they're deceased. It may even be meaningful to them to remember the person in their deceased state. And so this is really something that's going to vary from individual to individual and from culture to culture. It is known that different people and different cultures show their respect and love for the dead in different ways. And I understand in your case, you know, it may not be for you, but the person who gave you the photo, I would think of them charitably. This is the way that they find meaningful to respect and show their love for the deceased person. And they were trying to help you also show your respect and help remember the person and display your love for the person by remembering them. And it may not be your way of doing it, but they were trying to be helpful. And so I would be understanding of what they did, even if it's not your preference.
Thank you, Sarah. I hope that was helpful to you. Coming right back here to San Diego now. Ryan in San Diego, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Ryan, thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Thank you for taking my call. I have two related questions. Mm-hmm. My first is, I understand that Protestants have a valid sacrament of marriage. Mm-hmm. So my question would be, if somebody leaves the Catholic Church and becomes a Protestant and then marries another Protestant, would this be a sacramental marriage? And my second related question would be, if this wedding were to take place in a Vegas-style 24-hour chapel where there are no witnesses other than the civil minister, would this also be a valid sacramental marriage?
Okay. So these are really, I'll separate these two questions. In regard to getting married in a Vegas chapel, assuming that you are not bound to observe the Catholic form of marriage, the marriage would be presumed valid because it's being done in accord. It's a public act. It's being done in accord with the laws of the state of Nevada. Whether the minister only is the witness or whether there are additional witnesses there. And I think usually in a Vegas chapel, they will have, I mean, I've never been to Vegas, so I've never been to a Vegas chapel. Psychellet, which is more likely? Jimmy Akin has been to Vegas or Jimmy Akin has been to Vegas and been to a Vegas wedding chapel?
I'm going to go with A, Jimmy Akin has been to Vegas.
There you go.
But
okay.
Neither sounds very likely, but since you said you've never been there.
Neither is actually true. But my understanding is that they typically do have other witnesses, even if it's another employee of the chapel, like the organist or receptionist or something, and that they also would sign the marriage certificate for the state of Nevada. Even if I'm wrong about that, though, what's that?
Sorry, I should add that this is a personal question, and when
okay.
I was out of the church and I got married as a Protestant, I got married this way, and there were no additional witnesses.
Yeah, okay.
So I'm
well,
wondering if I'm still sacramentally married, even though I'm civilly divorced.
Okay, I'll get there. But just to deal with the chapel question, as long as the chapels are marriage is meant to be a public act, and this would be a public act because it was done in front of a minister, in front of a witness, and it was then recorded as such in the state of Nevada in compliance with the laws of the state of Nevada. So that would not be a barrier to it being a valid marriage. What would be a barrier is the fact that you had previously been Catholic. Now, after 1983, for a period of years, if you were a Catholic who had formally defected from the church, you were not required to observe the Catholic form of marriage. But that exception was later removed from the law. What year did this marriage occur?
In 2016.
Okay. By 2016, the requirement had been, the exception for formal defection had been removed from the law. And so the way the law is written today, if you are ever a Catholic, and even if you leave the church, you are still bound to the Catholic form of marriage. And so in the church's view, the way the law is written today, you would not be validly married and you would be free to marry someone else.
And that brings up the break. Sorry, we got to head to the break, but we'll be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin.
Hello, this is Archbishop Alexander Sample of the Archdiocese of Portland in Oregon. Keep that dial right here on Catholic Answers Live.
Can you defend the Church's teaching on the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist? Do you desire a deeper relationship with our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament? Join us September 22nd through 25th for the annual Catholic Answers Conference in San Diego. This year's theme is the Eucharist. I am with you always. Featuring all the Catholic Answers speakers and special guest Bishop Thomas Papracki, use promo code EARLY to save $50 when you register at CatholicAnswersConference.com.
Want to know more about the origins of the Catholic Church? Joe Heschmeyer explores the beginnings of Christianity. In the early church was the Catholic Church. Joe digs deep into the words and actions of those who lived right after the apostles, to refute anti-Catholic claims of how the faith was lived back then. Order your copy of The Early Church Was the Catholic Church today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Have you rescued a pet and why? We're doing a part two about that.
We want to hear about it tomorrow on Take Two with Jerry and Debbie.
On most of these EWTN stations.
Now we return to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live, Open Forum. Jimmy Akin here with us, and you're welcome to call if you'd like. I think there's looks to me like there might be a line or two open. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Let's see. We're going to Cicero, Indiana. Blake in Cicero, Indiana, listening on 90.9 FM. You there with us, Blake?
I'm here.
All right. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Yes, me and my wife just had our 6-month baby girl baptized in the Catholic
Church. Yay! Awesome. Congratulations.
Saturday. Thank you. And we both, when we got to the car, we both heard our priest say that she will not receive the fullness of the Holy Spirit till confirmation. Mm-hmm. And maybe we just misheard him, but if that's true, I'd like you to elaborate that for us.
Yeah, if that's what he said, then he said it in a pastorally unhelpful way, because he said it in a kind of glasses half empty, depressing way. He could have said it better like this. And when your child is confirmed, they'll receive even more of the Holy Spirit.
There you go. Yeah.
See how the framing makes all the difference? So we receive the Holy. Yeah. We receive the Holy Spirit in baptism. And at once you're baptized, that's the fundamental transformation. Everything that happens after that is secondary. Baptism is the big transformation. It's when regeneration and the bestowal of new life happens. And it's true that we do receive the Holy Spirit in other ways throughout the Christian life, including confirmation. Confirmation is the second sacrament of initiation. The third is the Eucharist. And we do indeed receive the Holy Spirit in a new way to empower us for Christian living in confirmation. We've already received the Holy Spirit to regenerate us and make us fit for eternal life in baptism. But we don't want to look at baptism as in any way inferior. The truth is we can receive the Holy Spirit in multiple ways throughout the Christian life, and not all of them associated with the sacraments. If you read the book of Revelation, John, on more than one occasion, in the process of receiving the vision of Revelation, says, "Then I was in the Spirit, and this happened." So he receives the Holy Spirit multiple times in the course of the same vision. So we shouldn't think of the Holy Spirit's action in our lives as a one-time thing, or baptism as being an inadequate or inferior reception of the Holy Spirit. It's the fundamental reception of the Holy Spirit in terms of becoming a Christian and being made fit for eternal life. And other receptions of the Holy Spirit are to be welcomed as things that are blessings from God that will also help us and help others. So I would say that your priest just phrased the matter badly, and it would be better to talk about the blessings that one receives from additional receptions of the Holy Spirit.
Okay, Blake?
Okay, and it was a beautiful service, and we love our priest.
Awesome. Oh, praise God for that. Blake, I have a question for you. Do you live in Cicero, Indiana?
I do.
Yeah, it was spelled a little creatively on my screen, and after I read it, I realized, oh, that was a reference to Cicero, Indiana. So I apologize to everyone in Cicero.
Those persnickety German-inspired Latin scholars will tell you the correct pronunciation is Cicero, Indiana.
Then I'm sorry that you got the name of your own town wrong, Blake. Thanks for the call, Blake. Hey, I'd like to send you a copy of The Bible as a Catholic Book. As I've said many times, when people have new babies, it's one of baby's favorite books. They love that book. So hang on. We're going to send you The Bible as a Catholic Book. If you'd like it, we'll send it to Cicero, Indiana, so you and the baby can enjoy it. I'm going to North Carolina now. Chris in North Carolina watching on YouTube. Chris, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hey, thanks for taking my call. I have a quick question. I've heard you, Jimmy, state his interpretation of Revelation chapter 20 and the first resurrection. Mm-hmm. I recently stumbled across a book that I've had for years, and it's called The Apocalypse of John by Milton Spencer Terry. I'm not sure if you're familiar with him or not.
He was a Protestant commentator.
Back in the 1800s, he wrote around the time James Stuart Russell, The Parousia. He takes pretty much the same interpretation. However, he doesn't go as far. He does believe that the first resurrection was a bodily resurrection, and he believes that it happened in AD 70. However, he does affirm that at the end of the 1,000 years, that the rest of the dead will be raised. So he does affirm that a bodily resurrection for the rest of the dead.
Would
it be a heresy for someone to take that position, to believe that there was a resurrection, the first resurrection, a bodily resurrection in 70 AD, but still affirm that at the end of the 1,000 years, there would be a bodily resurrection of the rest of the dead?
So if one were to deny that there is a future resurrection, a resurrection that's still in our future, if you were to say there's not going to be a future resurrection, that it's all been done, that's a view called pantillism, meaning everything is ended, then that would be a heresy, because the creed contains the everything in the creed is defined as dogma, and a heresy is the denial of a dogma after baptism. So so if someone were to say, so in the creed we say, I look forward to the resurrection of the dead. Well, okay, there's a future resurrection. That's a dogma. And so to willfully, culpably refuse to believe a dogma after baptism is a heresy. And so it would be a heresy to say there is no future resurrection. But it would not, therefore, be a heresy to say, I think some people were resurrected in AD 70. I would say that's a problematic view. I would say that it's quite problematic, but it would not be a heresy to say that, because it is not a dogma that there were no people resurrected in AD 70. So it wouldn't be heretical, but I would say it's very problematic.
Okay.
Thanks, Chris.
Thank you for that answer. That I understand. And I do want to just say one more thing. Mm-hmm. I became a monthly donor back in May.
Awesome.
And well, and they I have received the magazine, however I have not received the shirt or your book.
Oh,
not to play your book, but I was really, really looking forward to the t-shirt.
Tell you what, Chris, why don't you stay on the line and give your contact information to the call screener, and we'll get that over to customer service so that they can address the situation.
Yeah, we can't have you running around half naked, Chris.
I resent the email, but
okay. So hang on, we're gonna get your information. I think it's Sarah, and she'll get your information, and we'll make sure that this happens. And thanks for supporting us, Chris. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
All right, we got time. Let's go down to Tampa, Florida. Watching on YouTube, Andrew in Tampa, Florida. Glad you're here, Andrew. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
So would Adam and Eve have suffered a physical death if they hadn't eaten a fruit in Genesis, or was it more spiritual?
Well, no, the literal interpretation of the text would be that they physically would have died. Now, it's not simply that they ate the fruit that resulted in their death. There were two trees in the garden, the way Genesis presents it. One was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and the other was the tree of life. And Adam, after they eat, and they're told they can't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and then after they do, God expels them from Eden so that they can't eat of the tree of life, which would allow them to live forever. Now, there's a question about how would you eat the tree of life in order to live forever? Do you need to do it just once? Like you take one bite from a tree of life fruit and that's it, you're immortal? Or do you need to keep eating it so that it physically sustains you? And the text really doesn't settle that question for us. Personally, I tend to lean towards the repeated application view, but I could be mistaken. If they had not eaten of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, then they would have been able to stay in the garden and eat from the tree of life either once or repeatedly, and that would have enabled them to continue to have physical life. It is physical death we're talking about here. There is also such a thing as spiritual death, which they suffered when they ate the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, but that's not the death that we're talking about, at least in the literal sense of the text. There's also another question of how literal should we take all of this, because the church acknowledges that early Genesis contains symbolic elements, and the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is one of those symbolic elements. And the same is very likely true of the tree of life. This is likely, it's not just as it probably wasn't really a fruit that our first parents ate to disobey God. That's just a symbol of their act of disobedience. Probably the tree of life is also a symbol of immortality rather than something they would literally have to eat.
Okay, Andrew.
Sounds good. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Andrew. We got to take a quick break. Right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
St. John Paul II stated that, for the disciple of Christ, evangelization is a duty, an obligation of love. And the Catechism of the Catholic Church states that evangelization is necessary for salvation.
So we know we're called, but how do we do it?
St. Paul Street Evangelization can help. To learn more, contact us at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
By providing quality programming faithful to the teachings of the Catholic Church, EWTN is television that viewers can trust. Whether it's films, documentaries, news coverage, lively discussion shows, or kids' programs, we highlight the truth that is the eternal Word. For a complete schedule of EWTN television programs, visit EWTN.com and click TV. EWTN, the Global Catholic Network.
Welcome back, Catholic Answers Live. Having more fun, probably, than we should be allowed to have. Talking about the Catholic faith, more morality. Oh,
let's have more fun anyway.
I don't know who's making these rules, but we're just going to have fun anyway. Let's go down to Florida again. Vanessa in Florida, listening to EWTN on iHeartRadio. Vanessa, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, how are you guys doing?
Very well, thank you.
So, my question is, piggybacking off of talking about the apparition, I've seen, now I'm still a baby in my faith, so I get confused very easily. Lately, seen a lot of people speak about, you know, when somebody passes away and we like to say, oh, they're watching over you. People stating that that's not fact because in Ecclesiastics it states that the dead know nothing. So I don't know how that goes along with the church's belief as far as apparitions, and what is that really what that scripture even means, or is that just our interpretation?
Okay, so the book of Ecclesiastes is unique in terms of the scriptures. It is a wisdom book, which means it's focused on practical philosophical issues like what's the best way to live and so forth. But it's a book of, even though it's divinely inspired, it's a book of human wisdom. So these are things that the author has been reasoning about, and he presents you with his what he's reasoned. He's not like a prophet relying on God to give him visions and tell him things. He's just using a kind of early philosophical reasoning to try to figure out what's the best way to live. How can we make sense of this life? And God is working in the background because this is an inspired book, but it's not like he is giving us information that was revealed in a vision or in hearing God's voice or anything like that. What he's presenting to us is a wise philosophical perspective. And we have to take that into account when we read it. Now, one of the things that the book of Revelation stresses is that it's being written from a perspective of what happens in this world and what you can deduce by observing things in this world. And the phrase that the author of Ecclesiastes uses, to express that is under the sun. So when he talks about things in this world, he talks about things under the sun, not things that are in the afterlife or, you know, completely outside of this world. What he's doing is reasoning from the perspective of a wise man under the sun and what he can figure out. Well, given ordinary human experience, we don't ordinarily talk to the dead or hear back from the dead. Ordinarily, I talk to Cy Kellett, for example, here on the show, but I don't ordinarily have conversations where I hear back from my deceased wife. So from a perspective of what happens in this life under the sun, the dead don't seem to know anything. We're not interacting with them. We're not communicating with them. We're not telling them stuff. From a purely this worldly perspective, they would not seem to know what's happening. And that's what the author of Ecclesiastes is saying in Ecclesiastes 9, where he says in starting in verse 5, for the living know that they will die, and that's true, we do know that, but the dead know nothing. They have no further reward, and even the memory of them is forgotten. So they're not receiving any new benefits from God in this life. You know, they're not getting new rewards, they're not obeying God, they're not getting bountiful crops and all of the other things that ancient Hebrews thought of as rewards. People in this life are even forgetting them. In verse 6, their love, their hate, and their jealousy have long since vanished. They're not doing any of those things anymore in this world. Never again will they have a part in anything that happens under the sun. So the author here is talking from the perspective of what was known in his time from a this worldly perspective. But what was known in his time from a this worldly perspective is not everything. Later, God revealed, now it was already believed that there was an afterlife. It was a very common belief. It was the standard belief in every culture that there's an afterlife, and it certainly was in ancient Israel. That's why in Deuteronomy, which was written before Ecclesiastes, you have commandments: don't patronize mediums or consulters of the dead, because people would do that. They would have questions. They would want to get information from the supernatural world. So they would go to a medium who would contact a dead person for them, and then they'd ask their questions. And we even see King Saul doing that. He calls up the spirit of the prophet Samuel, and the text in 1 Samuel, the book where this is recorded, says that it's Samuel. And that's confirmed in the book of Sirach, that it was Samuel. So you have people believing that there is an afterlife and even trying to consult with the dead, although that's forbidden. But that's an extraordinary experience. That's not the experience, that's not an ordinary experience that we all have. And so the author of Ecclesiastes is focusing on ordinary experiences. Not extraordinary ones like a ghost shows up and starts talking to you. That's not the kind of data that is within his field of view as he's reasoning his way through these problems. Also, God later on revealed that not only is there an afterlife, there's also going to be a resurrection. And that's something that simply had not been revealed at the time that the author of Ecclesiastes was writing. And so he does not take that into account in his reasoning through these problems. So Ecclesiastes is a useful book to read, but it is also limited in its perspective. As we've talked about in other shows, there is something known as progressive revelation, where people earlier in the Bible know less than what people later in the Bible know about, because God revealed his revelation in stages. And at this point, the resurrection of the dead had not been revealed. There was a belief in the afterlife, but people didn't ordinarily interact with the dead, and the dead ordinarily did not, you know, seem to know anything. And that's the perspective that the author of Ecclesiastes is reasoning from.
Vanessa, I'd like to send you a copy of Jimmy's book, The Bible is a Catholic Book, if you'd like it. I think as you study the scripture as you are, it'll be very helpful to you. So if you want to hang on the line, I'll send that to you. And let's see, where am I going next? I'm going to Dan in St. Louis, Missouri, watching on YouTube. Hi, Dan, you there with us?
Yeah, hi. Hi, guys. Hi. My question is about fasting. In the Bible, our Lord Jesus said that certain demons can only be cast out by prayer and fasting, I believe, indicating that fasting does have power, extra power, when added with prayer. So my question is, how does the church teach that we're supposed to fast? Is it bread and water? If so, how much bread? And is it three times a day, two times a day you can only eat? Or would it be one regular meal once a day? And then once you do fast and pray, how much power does the fasting accompanied with prayer add to your powers? Like, for instance, praying to have a loved one who has fallen away from the faith to come back to the faith, and therefore get to heaven eventually. So how much power would the fasting add to the praying?
Okay, so let's deal with part of that second question first. There's no mathematical way to calculate this. There aren't spiritual energy points that you can total up based on the disciplines you perform. And so we really have to leave that in God's hands. Also, if you're going to do any kind of significant form of self-denial or any significant kind of penance, you need to get a spiritual director to make sure that it's performing the function that it's designed to perform, which is to help you grow closer to God, and that you're not doing it in a way that would damage you, because people can damage themselves by engaging in excessive spiritual disciplines. So you need to get a spiritual advisor who can give you an outside perspective on, you keep them informed about, here's what I'm doing, here's what's happening, and they can give you a perspective on whether this is reasonable for you or whether you should cut back or do more or do something else. But you don't want to engage in significant spiritual disciplines all on your own. You need an outside advisor to help you keep it balanced and productive. In terms of how to fast, there is not a single answer. The church does have regulations for the mandatory fasting that occurs 2 days of the year, which are Ash Wednesday and Good Friday. And on those days, you're allowed to eat one full meal and some food on two other occasions during the day. Obviously, some food is less than a full meal. Sometimes you'll hear people say, and they can't add up to a second full meal, but that's not what the law says. That's people exaggerating. What the law says is you can have one full meal and some food twice. But that's a minimum. And that's only required on 2 days of the year. If one is fasting for a spiritual purpose, it's voluntary fasting. And there is a range of different degrees of fasting, and none of them are mandated by the church. Personally, I do fasting. I do a 22-hour fast where, except like on Sundays because it's the Lord's Day, I will typically, at least when I'm observing the discipline strictly, I will only eat for a two-hour window in the evening, and the next 22 hours I don't eat anything. Some people will, although I do allow myself to have sodas, which don't have calories, some people will adopt an even stricter fast. They may go for days without eating, and that can be done in a perfectly healthy way. The longest fast that's on record was a medical fast done in the 1960s of a gentleman from Scotland who fasted for like 400 days and dropped. He took vitamins and water, but otherwise he didn't eat, and he lost a lot of weight, which he needed to do in his case. If you'd like to learn more about fasting, you can go to my personal website, jimmyakin.com/fast, F-A-S-T. So jimmyakin.com/fast. It has some more information about fasting, but really it's up to you what kind of fasting you want to do. You can change the kind of fasting over time. You can ask God to bless it by helping a loved one or a friend come back to the faith. But there's no way to mathematically calculate that. And you need to do it with a spiritual director who can you can check in with and make sure that you're not that you're doing this fasting in a productive way.
Thank you for the question, Dan. Thank you for two great hours, Jimmy.
My pleasure, Cy Kellett.
And that'll do it for us. We'll see you tomorrow, God willing, right here, Catholic Answers Live.